Thank you, Rod and Steve. Many thanks for the invitation. It's an honor to present here at Allied Health Professionals Forum in this wonderful city of Milan. My name, as stated, was Jessica Tambour, physical therapist, and I will start with the first part of the presentation. My primary goal is to inform you about the multidisciplinary Allied Health Practice Guidelines for Physical, Speech and Occupational Therapy in ALS, which we developed in the Netherlands. I will describe the method we use to make this guideline, and the second part of the presentation, as Rod stated, will be done by Sandra Offenga, speech therapist and speech language pathologist, and she will describe the multidisciplinary aspects of the guideline. Afterwards, there's the opportunity to ask questions about the three different guidelines. Jorinde Oudenaarde, who is responsible for the occupational therapy guideline, will also answer questions about the occupational guideline. And furthermore, as you can see, Dr. Marieke van der Schaaf was the supervising coordinator of the whole project. In general, evidence-based practice guidelines add to the improvement of and quality and effectiveness of patient care. Also, use of guidelines will improve standardization and transparency of the therapeutic process and will encourage multi and interdisciplinary collaboration. However, such guidelines are not available for the different allied healthcare professions involved in ALS care. The multidisciplinary allied health practice guidelines for physical, speech and occupational therapy was commissioned by the Netherlands ALS Center under leadership from Professor Leonard van den Berg. The development was a collaboration with the Reade Center for Rehabilitation and Rheumatology in Amsterdam, the Radboud University Medical Center in Nijmegen, and the Academic Medical Center in Amsterdam. Also, representatives of the three allied health consortiums in the development, and the patient organization of neuromuscular diseases participated in the development of the guideline. Additionally, a panel of patients was selected to give feedback on each step during the development of the guideline. I would like to tell you somewhat more about ALS care in the Netherlands, particularly who is involved in patients with ALS in the Netherlands. We have a core team that consists of a rehabilitation specialist who is actually the day-to-day coordinator of the care, a neurologist, occupational therapist, speech therapist, a social worker, dietitian, psychologist, physical therapist, and some ALS teams have a nurse or nurse practitioner or care coach linked to an ALS team who supports the clinic for ALS or patients with PSMA. In addition, these teams are working often closely with a gastroenterologist, a pulmonologist, and a nutrition team, or a hepatologist, doctors from the Center of Home Ventilation, and an orthoptist. But also, when the patient becomes more dependent and gets more difficult to transfer to an ALS team, the focus on care takes more place at home, with a key role for a general practitioner, home care nursing, volunteers, etc. The guideline contains a summary, evidence-based experts and opinions, which sums up conclusions and recommendations, and a quick reference guide with an appendix with measurements and other things such as protocols concerning air stacking and mechanical in- and exsufflation. The guideline was developed according to the model of the Dutch Institute for Healthcare Improvements, evidence-based guideline development. I will now describe the circle you can see on the slide. It contains the following steps. The first step was a problem analysis and to identify relevant questions. This was done by the first author. Then these questions were sent to an expert working group of physical, occupational and speech therapists and patients. This was done under supervision of the Netherlands ALS Center, and it resulted in 50 key questions for speech therapists, 51 for physical therapists, and 42 questions for occupational therapists. The next step was to perform a systematic literature search. And the literature was searched between January 1996 and March 2011. We searched PubMed, Cochrane Neuromuscular Diseases Group, CINA, Ovid Medline, Embase, and other librarians, and also at internet using, for example, WWW Guideline, NICE, SIGN, and other aspects. Also, abstracts of conference meeting were included. Quality assessment and summary of the evidence took place, which I will show you more about next. Formulations of concept recommendations took place, and then there was another round with the expert working group. Feedback was given again, and the recommendations were rephrased. Final approval and authorization by relevant stakeholders was given. And here you can see this in a schematic way. The evidence was graded as follows. A1, the systematic reviews or a minimum of independently performed level A2 studies. A2 studies are randomized, double-blind, comparative clinical trials of good quality and sufficient size. B, comparative research, but not with all the measures, with all the features mentioned under A2. This includes case control studies and cohort studies. C, non-comparative studies, or D, the expert opinion or the working group. Then classification of the level of evidence took place, and the following classification was used. Level 1, conclusions. We came to this conclusion when there was a trial of level A1 or at least two independently performed trials of level A2. The conclusions are described in the guideline as it has been shown that. Level 2 conclusions are trials of level A2 or at least two independently conducted studies of level B. And conclusions are described as it is likely that. Level 3 are level B or C trials. And conclusions are described as there are indications that. And finally, level 4, expert opinion or working group. Conclusions are described as experts believe that or the working group believes that. The recommendations are a product of the available evidence combined with clinical expertise and patients' needs and preferences. So, in addition to the scientific evidence, other aspects are of importance. For example, organizational aspects, the need for special equipment, expertise of therapists, and to determine if a recommendation is in fact suitable for daily practice. These issues are listed under the heading Other Consideration. So the recommendation is the result of integrating the findings from the literature with the other recommendations. Maybe that the strength of a recommendation is less strong or stronger than the level of conclusion. I will now show you this example. The question here was which physical therapy interventions are recommended to influence pain. There are two conclusions described. You can read it also if you like. Level 3, there are indications that a supervised exercise program with strengthening exercises and functional training has positive effects on pain, muscle stiffness, strength, and preserved muscle length in patients with ALS. This was a study done by Aksu in 2002. A level 4 conclusion was that the expert working group believes that TENS, and TENS is an electric small device where a pulse is given through the skin that stimulates the nerves and will reduce pain. So TENS, massage, passive mobilization, and advice on posture can be considered in the treatment of pain due to CERAMENAGE in patients with ALS. Other considerations are the evidence does not give enough information to be meaningful in daily practice. The question of which intervention is most appropriate for the different types of pain, such as pain due to muscle weakness or spasm or spasticity, cannot be answered. When there is pain due to muscle weakness, it does not seem appropriate to describe an active exercise program aimed at maintaining muscle strength. Johnson was a study done in 2007, found that TENS may be an effective treatment for patients with chronic musculoskeletal pain. This leads to the following recommendation. The physical therapist can consider a supervised exercise program aimed at maintaining muscle strength with, for example, functional training, if the pain is not due to muscle weakness. In addition, the physical therapist may consider to apply TENS, massage, passive mobilization, and advice on posture. Here you can see a slide of the ICF, the International Classification of Functioning, Disability and Health, formed the base of the guideline. Conclusions and recommendations on assessment and therapeutic interventions for occupational speech and physical therapist were categorized into relevant domains for patients with ALS, bringing on the most relevant key problems. The recommendations cover all treatment stages, integrating evidence from research and clinical expertise of expert healthcare professionals. In this slide, you can see the most relevant domains of the ICF for patients with ALS, with no mentioning of subgroups. One of the examples of a multidisciplinary recommendation is number 21. In case of breathing problems, it is recommended that the speech therapist, physical therapist, and occupational therapist collaborate in a coordinated plan. Now my colleague, Ms. Sandra Ochinga, will tell you more about the multidisciplinary recommendations. Thank you very much.
So, Jessica told you all about the guideline history and the framework. Let me tell you about how it works. In a way, we see in the Netherlands the best treatment for patients with ALS. It's not only a multidisciplinary one, but preferably an interdisciplinary one. The guideline content, you've just seen this slide before. I'll pick up the part with you, conclusions and recommendations, and the quick reference guides. The conclusions and recommendations for all the three disciplines, we made them on the five following sections, starting with the referral and ending up with the evaluation of the therapy process. In this presentation, I use ICOMs because they're international and they're easy to understand. And just to test you in the audience, to which country refers these ICOMs to? Can't hear you? Yes, it's the Italian way. So if you understand this one, you will understand the rest of my presentation. Let's illustrate the guideline by presenting you a patient case. The blue one is a patient with ALS who visits the rehabilitation doctor with respiratory complaints. The doctor will ask patient history, examines the patient, and concludes physical therapy will be needed, and he writes a referral. The patient visits the physical therapist. The physical therapist asks complementary history and uses to do this the quick reference guides. After the patient history, he examines the respiratory problems. Which assessment tools he uses is advised by recommendation number 12. Hopefully this one is all familiar to you. I'll just give you a few seconds to read. During the physical therapy assessment of the patient with ALS, the physical therapy notes short of breathing during speech. He discusses it with the patient with ALS, who actually confirms having a weak voice and lack of breath support in conversations. So the interdisciplinary meeting will follow. The physical therapist brings in the examination results and asks what to do about the respiratory insufficiency during speech. A team discussion will follow and ends up with the doctor's referral from the patient with ALS to the speech therapist. So next, this patient with ALS visits the speech therapist. Specific speech therapy questions for patient history is done by using the quick reference guide number 1. This is an example, and I'll explain to you the construction of the quick reference guide to give you a good idea how it works. The left column is the ICF system of impaired functioning. The middle column is about activity limitations and participation restrictions. And the right one will be the external factors. And considering in our patient case with respiratory problems, this will be the part of questioning for the breathing system, considering the speech therapy part. After the patient history, assessment will follow. And on the subject of breathing, here you can find the subjects you need to check if you are a speech therapist. The measurements you need to do your assessment is summarized in the second block. And only in rare cases, the speech therapist needs complementary results, and these examinations can be done by what's subscribed in the third block. After completing the assessment, the speech therapy suggests the patient with ALS should need a short period of speech therapy. This is the quick reference guide that shows you how the speech therapy will be working. I call it the columns for you because the quick reference guides, unfortunately for you, are in Dutch. The left column, the blue one, is about the impaired functions. The second one, green, will be telling you the therapy call you can make up in your therapy. The third orange one is about the strategy you need to use to reach your set goal. But next to these three important aspects, we also have a separate column for cooperation, and that's the yellow one. So in our patient case with the respiratory problems, this is the breathing part, this is who you cooperate with, and this will be the very most important part of this schedule. Back to the patient case, how to do the speech therapy is advised by recommendation number 25. I'll give you again a few seconds to read. So the speech therapy brings in the interdisciplinary meeting, the results of the assessment, and makes the suggestion that the occupational therapist would be successful for the speech therapy exercise success. So a new discussion follows, and the speech therapy results combined with the physical therapy conclusion will be lead to the opinion that an occupational therapist is needed for postural adjustments. So the rehabilitation doctor writes his referral to the occupational therapist. The patient with ALS visits the occupational therapist. Specific questioning is done by using the quick reference guides for occupational therapy, followed by assessment done by another quick reference guide. This will be summarized in recommendation number 7. So I think you need to absorb this one, so take a few seconds to read again. As a result, this patient with ALS ends up in an adjusted chair with upright body posture, taking many breathing pauses during the sentences he's saying with a good speech volume. As one will conclude, an overall recommendation on respiratory problems is recommendation number 21. It is recommended that the speech therapist, physical therapist, and occupational therapist collaborate in a coordinated plan. So far, the patient case. Next one will be the summary of this presentation. We have made a unique product of three combined guidelines. They are simultaneously developed, so it enables an interdisciplinary as good as a multidisciplinary recommendations. It's evidence and practice based, and it's really easy to use with the CRIC reference guides. Our take home message, we would like you to give you this one in a Ferrari red car. Eventually we are in Italy, aren't we? We'd like to see the ALS multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary care performed by an interdisciplinary team, like in the Formula One. The one in the driving seat is the patient with ALS, not trying to make the fastest round as possible, but making slow rounds with good quality of life. He is regularly making a pit stop by seeing the rehabilitation doctor and specialized ALS therapists that are necessary at that very moment. These mechanics working all together and cooperation is really essential. So the guideline will help the individual therapist, but also facilitates the interdisciplinary approach. And we'd like to thank a few collaborations who funded our project. That will be the Netherlands ALS Center, whose coordination is Professor Dr. Leonard van den Berg, and the ALS Foundation Netherlands. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for that presentation. Jessica and Sandra have been joined by Jorind and are open to questions.
Hi, Kelly Saunders from London. I just want to ask something about methodology. You said you, in terms of the experts and how you identified and got them on board, can you just tell us how you found your experts and what process went through to get them?
In the Netherlands, the Netherlands ALS Center has a map of all ALS teams in the Netherlands, and there are specific criteria on which one must fulfill to get on the map. For example, you must see enough patients a day per year, and maintain a high level of quality of standard. So that was, so we used persons from that map to ask them if they wanted to join the expert working group. And in addition, we had an expert working group of physical speech and occupational therapists who formed the primary working group. But as we described the recommendations, and then they get sent out for the second round, we ask a larger group, which also included nurses, doctors for the home care ventilation, and social workers, and all other physical therapists, speech therapists, and as many as we could get, frankly.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Hi, Helen Carey from Chester. I'm interested in the referrals. It seemed that there was a cascade from one to the other to the other, and each time a consultant needed to do the referral. Would it not be sensible within the guidelines that if there was respiratory problems, the consultant referred to all three of you, and then you could do the established practice? Perhaps it was just the example that...
Well, in Holland we have the system that the rehabilitation doctor is in charge of the ALS M&D team, and actually we don't have every week a meeting where we discuss all the patients, new ones and regular ones. So we have also very small separate meetings, just the occupational or the speech therapist, with together always with the rehabilitation doctor, and not always all the team attending the meeting, but because then it takes too long to get a new referral. But always the doctor needs to make the consideration if it's necessary, and he discusses it with the patient before he gives the referral, because you need to see if the patient is ready for it, and you can't do all therapy every day coming to the hospital or home visits. That's too much a burden.
Thank you. Christian at the back.
I'm Catherine Atkinson from the Wolfrey Community Neuro Team. It looks amazing, and I was just thinking, I don't speak Dutch, and I would love to have a look at it. Have you got any thoughts of getting it translated into any other languages, or sharing it in any other way? Because, like I say, I'd love to have a proper nose through it.
Yeah. Well, thank you for the compliment. It's our opinion too, but we're still looking for some funding. That's the main issue right now.
Surprising how money is at the root of all evil and prevents all progress. There's a question down the front here.
Perhaps I'm just repeating what the last but one person said. I'm just a bit anxious about the patient's journey through this system that you've got, and thinking how long that might take to get the respiratory, a proper respiratory assessment done, and actually decide what you're going to do about it. Because well, just that description sounded like three meetings, four referral letters, three or four assessments of the patient, and I'm sure it is simpler than that.
I can give you some relief. It looks that way on paper, but in the daily practice, it's many of our patients don't live nearby an ALS team. So, for example, I'm a physical therapist, but maybe the patient has another physical therapist at home where he can go to twice a week, for example. But still, the physical therapist of the ALS team will do consults every 2 to 3 months, dependent on how progression goes. And every 2 to 3 months, for example, the respiration is monitored. And when the physical therapist sees that it has a decline, for example, then it is one of the other recommendations. There are red flags described. So when it falls under beneath a certain value, then the physical therapist directly has to contact the rehabilitation specialist, who takes another step to go to, for example, the pulmonologist or the center for home care ventilation. So that's quite done very fast, and it's also described in the guideline. Then, when the physical therapist at home sees these red flags concerning breathing, for example, he will directly contact the physical therapist or the rehabilitation specialist of the ALS team by phone or email to describe them to the ALS team. So.
And I'd like to suggest another thing. We do combined consultations. So maybe sometimes the physical therapist is already starting therapy, but the next hour the speech therapy is doing the patient history. So it's a combined visit to get the less time of the patient as necessary.
That's really helpful, thank you.
Any other questions? No? Last chance? Well, please join with me in thanking our speakers.